Hello friends, welcome to Engineering Funda family. In this video, I'm going to explain you flow control mechanism in TCP. At the very beginning of this chapter in transport layer, I have told you flow control mechanism that is done in transport layer. If you have seen my first video based on this chapter of transport layer, in that I have explained you how we have flow control mechanism, right? And here we have transmitter and receiver. By this example, I have explained you what is flow control. See, flow control is a control of data transmission speed. For example, if transmitter is sending data with the speed of 10 Mbps, but as if receiver can handle up to 1 Mbps only, then this receiver cannot receive data which is forwarded by transmitter over here. So here receiver will give feedback to transmitter. In that feedback, receiver will say, I can handle up to 1 Mbps only. So you will have to transmit data with speed at max with 1 Mbps. So this is how flow control is happening. There can be another scenario even. Like as if transmitter is sending data with 10 Mbps speed. But if receiver can handle up to 100 Mbps speed, then receiver will give feedback to transmitter. It will say like, I can handle up to 100 Mbps. You are slow right now. See, this is how flow control mechanism that is happening, in which we will be controlling data rate in between two computers, right? So here in TCP, how it happens, that is what the case which I'm going to explain you in this video. So here, when it comes to flow control, first of all, you need to understand how many basics are there. See, flow control explains how transfer speed of data is adjusted in between two computers during data transmission. So as if one computer is slower compared to another, in that case there has to have adjustment of speed. And second scenario is even possible. If data transmission is happening with lower speed and if resources are having higher capabilities, then data transmission speed that can be increased over here. See, both of the possibilities are possible. And in TCP, to maintain flow control, see, these three tools, that is very, very essential. First is window scaling. Second is advertisement window size. And third is persistent timer. I'll explain you these three tools along with practical examples that will give you more clarity about how TCP handles flow control. Let me explain you that by one practical scenario. So here, see, we are having two computers, H1 and H2. And in TCP, you should know, what we do is, we do connection establishment at the very beginning. That is the first stage. Second stage is data transfer. And third stage is connection termination. Right. So in connection establishment, both of these computers will be performing three-way handshake. So there will be three segments that is getting forwarded over here in connection establishment. You see, this is first segment that is requested by H1. This is second segment, that is a reply to the segment forwarded by H1, right, by H2. And then there is acknowledgement. So by three segments, there is connection establishment. And in that, what is happening, you see, when H1 is forwarding request to H2, at the time, it will mention window size available at H1. See, window size explains you how much data that can be handled at H1, right? How much size of buffer is available at H1, that is mentioned by window size. Then H2 will give reply, in which it will give window size details of H2. So here you see H1 is saying my window size is 3000, and then H2 is saying, okay, my window size, that is 2000. So now H1 and H2 both knows what are the possible window size that is there in between these two computers. So here what will happen is, both of this computer will agree upon lower of these two window size. So H1 is having 3000, H2 is having 2000. But after this, they will get to know like, okay, we should be having 2000 window size as minimum of these two should get selected over here, right? So now you see, at H1 window size, that is 2000, and H2 window size is 2000, right? Now you see what is happening here. Here there is scaling of window size that we have done. Initially, H1 was having capability up to 3000 byte of window size and H2 was having 2000. But after connection establishment, they have scaled their window size to 2000 byte, right? So that is what the first key aspect of TCP flow control. Like, they will communicate with each other regarding their window size. And based on that, they can understand, okay, by that size only, we should be transferring data. Now you see what is happening secondly. Now, after connection establishment, H1 is communicating with H2. Here, let us consider H1 is forwarding data to H2. So you see, H1 is forwarding some data to H2. So as this data that is getting received by H2, its window size that will be getting filled up, right? So what will happen is, you see, here 1000 byte that is there inside this window. So only 1000 bytes are available. 1000 bytes that is getting buffered over here in this window. So only 1000 bytes are available. So here you see, this H2 is giving feedback to H1 regarding available window size, that is 1000 byte only. So this is what window advertisement. Like, initially they have agreed upon with 2000 byte of window size. But because of data that is getting buffered in this window, only 1000 byte is available. So this H2 is giving advertisement window size to H1. It indicates right now only 1000 byte is available with this window. The reason is 1000 byte is filled, right? Then H1 is forwarding data, and once that complete window that is getting filled over here, this H2 will give again advertisement window size, and it says to H1, my window is full, 0 byte is available right now. The reason is entire window that is full over here because of I have received data from you, right? So 0 byte is available. So here this H1 will stop sending the data. Why? The reason is, now H1 knows this window is full. So as if this window is full, there is no point of sending data over here. So here, see what is happening. You see here, advertisement of window size that host are doing during transmission. And by this advertisement of window size, what happens is, transmitter will get to know, like, okay, this much size of buffer that is available at receiver side, so that transmitter will not forward data which is more than that available buffer size, right? Now you see, there can be two scenarios which is possible over here. As if this window size that is full, then here this H1, now it will stop sending the data over here, right? But obviously, after some time, this data that will be given to application layer, see, transport layer will give data to application layer at receiver side, right? So after some time, this buffer data that will be given to application layer. So once the data that is given to application layer, this window will get empty by some extent. Like you see here, this H2 is having window which is available up to 1300 byte right now. So what H2 will do? H2 will do advertisement of window size over here. H2 will say, like, okay, my window is available by 1300 byte. But what if this frame, what if this segment is not received at H1? As if this segment is not received at H1, then H1 will never come to know, like, okay, now this window is available over here. So here there will be deadlock. Here there will be deadlock. Why there will be deadlock? The reason is, H1 is not sending data because of what reason? Because of H1 knows this window is full right now at H2 side. But after some time, H2 is saying, like, okay, my window is available up to 1300 byte, but that frame is not received over here. And because of this frame is not received over here, H1 will never get to know, like, okay, I can forward data in this direction to H2. So there will be deadlock. if this segment is not getting received over here. Obviously, if this segment is getting received, then from here onwards, H1 will start to forward the data. So here, there is very interesting concept, which is persistent timer, by which this deadlock that we can avoid. You see how? See, after some time, means after persistent timer, after some time, H1 will forward one frame. In that, there will be no data. In that, there will be no data. It will be a probe frame that you can see. So, in that probe frame, it will say this H2, are you free? Are you having available window size? Then, based on this frame, H2 will give reply, okay, right now I'm having complete window which is free, which is having size of 2000 byte. So, once this feedback received by H1 will forward the data from here onwards. But you see here, persistent timer that we are setting. Why? The reason is we want to avoid deadlock. See, if you communicate completely based on this acknowledgement, in that case, what is possible? In that case, as if this acknowledgement is not received by transmitter, in that case, there can be deadlock. Deadlock means this H1 will never get to know, like, okay, I should be transmitting data from here onwards, right? So there is persistent timer concept. After that, this H1 will forward probe frame, in which it will ask H2, are you free now? I have waited for some time period, and after that, you should be having some space in your window. So H2 will reply, okay, now I am having space of 2000 byte, you can forward the data. So that is how three essential concepts that you need to understand in flow control. First is window scaling. So window scaling that we do initially by giving details of window size at H1 and H2 side, and both of these computer will get agreed upon lower of those two window size, right? Minimum of those two window size, and then they will be initiating communication. During communication, there will be acknowledgement frame by receiver. Like you see, acknowledgement frame by receiver. In that, it will be doing advertisement of window size. Advertisement of window size means it will say, like, this much window that is available with me. If there is no space that is available, in that case, transmitter will have to stop sending off that data, right? And once that window is available, then receiver will give feedback, in which it will say, like, okay, this much size is available, you can forward the data. But there is always possibility of deadlock, as if this type of frame that is getting lost somewhere in the computer network. So here there is a concept of persistent timer. After persistent timer, there will be probe frame that is getting forwarded by transmitter, and based on that, again, we can resume the communication, right? So we are not only depending on that window advertisement, we are also having persistent timer concept, which will avoid deadlock situation in communication. So this is how complete flow control mechanism that is happening in TCP. Still, if you have any query, please note it down in comment section. I'll be happy to help you. Thank you so much for watching this video.